Today, Madam President, we mark Workers' Memorial Day when we honor and remember workers who've laid down their lives on the job. I've worn on my lapel, since I was in the House, Madam President, a pin depicting a canary in a birdcage given to me at a Workers' Memorial Day rally in Lorain, Ohio in the late 1990s. This pin depicts a canary going down in the mine. It suggests a mine worker taking a canary down in the mines. If the canary died from lack of oxygen or from toxic gas, the mine worker got out of the mines. He had no union strong enough to protect him and no government that cared enough to protect him in those days. To me, this pin represents the role of government to support the middle class and those who aspire to the middle class. It represents the progress we've made in the society we continue to fight for every day here. We know the story. Coal miners took the canary down in the mines. Throughout the 20th century, we've worked to change that. We passed worker safety laws and overtime pay. We banned child labor. We passed clean air, safe drinking water laws. We enact Social Security and Medicare and workers' rights and women's rights and civil rights. But despite that progress over the last year, too many workers have felt a whole lot like those miners. They felt like they're on their own. A moment ago, I mentioned the grocery store worker in Cincinnati who said, "They tell me I'm essential, but I feel expendable." That grocery store worker and thousands of others have been on the front lines of this pandemic, risking their lives so Americans could keep food on their table and get their packages delivered. They're changing linens in hospitals and driving buses and stocking shelves in supermarkets. Then workers go home at night and are anxious that they might spread the virus and affect their family. We know that hundreds of thousands of workers have been exposed to the virus on the job. Thousands have died. It's hard to get an exact count of how many because the previous administration didn't bother to keep track. We know the food and commercial workers reported last summer that more than 16,000 grocery store workers have been exposed. More than 100 had died. We know those numbers keep going up. The National Nurses United has recorded at least 3,200 healthcare workers have died. In meatpacking plants, the toll has been horrific. Last summer, 16,000 workers had been affected, the vast majority of them black and brown workers, more than 230 died. And yet all of last year, the Trump administration and too many large corporations failed to protect their workers. The corporate lawyers that ran the Labor Department from the top down refused to issue workplace safety requirements. Corporations ran a lot of feel-good TV ads saying thank you to essential workers, claiming these workers are the heart of their companies. But workers didn't ask for a PR campaign. They needed protections on the job. This Workers' Memorial Day today, we celebrate it every year, we remember the American workers who've lost their job, their lives on the job from this virus, sometimes from gun violence, sometimes from workplace accidents. We honor them best by fighting to protect these workers and their fellow workers to make their hard work pay off. Yesterday in the Banking and Housing Committee, we held the committee's first ever listening session. It was purely a listening session. No senators got to ask questions. We just came to listen with workers from Ohio and around the country to hear how the financial system affects their jobs and their lives. They shared powerful stories about their work, about how companies and economic policies prevent their hard work from paying off. We heard from a distribution worker in Ashtabula, Ohio. He told us, "We rarely go a few weeks without an injury, largely because of the insane pace we work at. We have suggested that slowing the pace even just a little would improve safety and could save money. We were told injuries don't cost this company much money." We heard from a Wells Fargo call center worker who talked about how the bank misclassified her to avoid paying overtime. They put her on salary. They said she was management. They worked her more than 40 hours. They never paid her an overtime dollar. We heard from a full-time gig worker who works for multiple corporations like Uber and Instacart. He works full-time. He has zero benefits because these companies claim he's an independent contractor. We heard from a Michigan worker who lost her job when a private equity firm bought out her company. They laid off 3,100 workers in the Detroit area, and they pocketed the money. We heard from a worker in West Virginia who talked about working her whole life and never seeing that hard work pay off. She said, "Working poor, the term working poor should not be two words that go together. If you work hard, you should be able to get ahead in this country. If you love this country, you fight for the people that make it work. If even a global pandemic where America's workers have been on the front lines, if even that won't get corporations to rethink their business model that treats workers as expendable, it's time to stop letting them run the company. That's what the new Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs Committee is all about. Wall Street had its chance. They failed. If corporate America won't deliver for its workers, then we have to create a better system centered on the dignity of work. That means safe workplaces. The Biden administration is taking us steps toward finally and issuing an OSHA emergency temporary standard. We went a whole year in the pandemic where the President of the United States simply refused, and the corporate lawyer that ran the Department of Labor simply refused to issue any standards on workplace safety. Think about that. Now it means laws and policies that reward work, like the Earned Income Tax Credit and the Child Tax Credit, which the Senator from New Hampshire is in this, the junior senator from New Hampshire is here and has been supportive of that, a strong overtime rule, ending misclassification that robs workers of their wages and their rights. It means a strong labor movement. Unions give people power in the job. People ought to have the option, if they choose, of joining a union, allowing them to join together to make their workplace safer. It's workers who make our economy successful. It's workers that allow corporations and Wall Street investors to rake in record profits. It's time for that hard work to pay off for all workers, no matter if you punch a clock or swipe a badge or work for salary or work for tips or take care of your parents or take care of your children, that work should be rewarded in this country. When you love this country, you fight for the people who wake at work on Workers' Memorial Day and the other 364 days of the year. Madam President, I yield the floor.